firstly, I welcome you to your college after 20 years. And I just wanted to ask, you came to this college after 20 years. So how does it feel coming back to your alma mater after so much time? And what changes do you see in this college?
Actually, it is always a very pleasant experience to come back to your alma mater. And it is also something very emotional to every student. We had passed one of the best phase of our life while doing engineering at this place. And as far as changes are concerned, so in past 20 years, there have been a lot of changes. I was just walking through the campus in the morning. First and most important change that has been like an institutional change. Earlier, we were affiliated to the Allahabad University. So for all our, you know, academic type of works, for knowing our results and all those things, we have to go to Allahabad University. And so that was also something like that of a status. So now at least we are a deemed university. We are in an independent institute. So everything is conducted at this place itself. So this was a very big institutional change. And in campus also, I was seeing that a lot of infrastructure facilities have been added. Like that training and placement unit that was being shown to me. Earlier, such type of things were not there. And many disciplines have come after we left the college. Earlier, there were only some conventional disciplines like mechanical, electrical, electronics, civil and production. Now there is biotechnology and chemical engineering. And there are a number of faculty members also. Then a management faculty has also been initiated. So there has been a lot of changes that I have seen.
So from Bachelor of Technology in Electrical Engineering to an IFS officer, so what was the reason of this transition in your career? So why do you opt for civil services?
Actually, in our civil services, irrespective of the problems and deficiencies and all other some negative developments, I think still it is a sort of employment in which you can get a tremendous amount of self-satisfaction. Even if you can get some one or two or three meaningful assignments, you can bring about the real changes. And for bringing out that type of changes, you can never get those type of changes even if you are working in voluntary sector, in NGOs or even in private sector. You are given so much powers at the very initial levels. And you have so much autonomy to bring about the changes. For example, just after 2 or 3 years of joining, of going into the civil service, you are in charge of an entire district. So there you can plan and implement and execute a number of things which can bring real change in the life of the people. You can bring justice to them. So this is one of the potential which is not there in any other employment. However, the salaries may be in the corporate sector or the private sector. So this was one of the main driving factor of my joining the civil services.
So what was the most cherishable moment in your in MN and IT in your olden days?
It is very difficult to recall. Actually, we used to have very good time with our friends. We had very close bonding, and even now our core group, we were three are very close friends. So coincidentally, now all of them are now in Delhi. Some are in corporate sector, and some of like me and one more my friend is in government sector. So till now we have that much warmth of relationship that we had 20 years back. So those were the most cherishable moments. Of course, out of the class, not in the class. So that we still remember, and we are always in touch. We are whether in the NCR region or in some other places. So we always remain in touch. So that bonhomie, that friendship, that is still intact even after 20 years. So you can just imagine that before 20 years, how much we would have been enjoyed.
So in your 13-year-long successful career, you have seen as many as 12 transfers within 7 months. Suspensions, death threats and charge sheets were filed against you. So sir, didn't it ever occur to you that why should I take so much pain? What was your constant source of motivation that kept you going for so long?
There were two factors. Basically, I come from Eastern UP, which is one of the most poor parts of our country. So right from my childhood, I have seen poverty from very close quarters. That how it is very difficult for a large portion of population of our country to just to survive, just to manage their daily food, how much difficult it is. And on the other hand, there are corrupt officers, corrupt politicians who have made millions, billions. So that created a sense of anger in me. I thought that if I get an opportunity to join to the civil services, I will try my best to correct the system. So there was a sense of conviction. And yes, I had very tough time. In my very first posting, I was placed under suspension and the entire establishment went against me, like filing police cases and all those powers which could have been abused against a civil servant was abused. But then, if you are on a path of truth, if you are pure, if you are your convictions are correct, so then always there are some powers, you can call it God or divine power or nature. So the way I was harassed in an unprecedented manner, similarly the relief also were very unprecedented. For example, in my case, even my suspension order was revoked by none other than President of India. And it was a very severe indictment of the state government. State government means Chief Minister of the state. So it was a very, very unprecedented intervention which had never occurred earlier. And then it happened that between 2008 to 2014, in 6 years, there were 4 presidential orders, which is a sort of history in the independent India, that in career of no other civil servant, so many presidential intervention had taken place. And particularly when the same political party was in the power in the state of Haryana and in the central government. So such type of unprecedented interventions, relief, they came. So they also, gave a source of strength to me that, yes, I am on the right path. And finally, whatever I had wanted in my career, I completed around 6 or 7 years of my service in Haryana cadre. I wanted to come out on central deputation. There were very strong resistance. Even my state government, they decided that they would not let me go. Even then, central government intervened in a very unusual way. I was made to join at this place. So, there were also very, relief or support from very unexpected quarters. So, these things kept me moving.
So, recently you were honored with the Ramen Magazine Award. I extend a hearty congratulations to you on behalf of all the United. So, how does it feel that after such a long, arduous struggle against corruption, your efforts were recognized in such a splendid manner?
Actually, frankly speaking, when I began my service, right from the very first posting, there were some very serious troubles. So, I had never worked for any award or sort of a position. I always knew what are the consequences. I know system very well because my father was also in the government service. So I knew that if I do this, how the system will react. I knew, so there was no element of surprise for me. So personally, I had never expected that all these things will bring some, and that to such a prestigious award for me in the career. But then, as I said earlier, that all this is, God's gift, or it is a message from some divine power. It was something just to cheer me up. But basically, after the awards were announced, what I found that all the honest and sincere civil servants from across the country, they all felt very happy. They all felt very encouraged. So this award was basically, a sort of moral booster for all the honest civil servants. And that was, the biggest part.
Sir, as you just said, there are many loyal government officials. But sir, when they try to confront Bhrasht Netas or Sarkari Babus, they are either transferred or suspension or are suspended. So sir, what provisions or changes must be brought in legislations to control or inhibit this policy, sir?
Actually, we have one of the best constitutions in our country. We have one of the best laid out laws, policies, manuals. The problem lies in the implementation and in our own character. When the constitution was framed, it was finalized. Then Dr. Ambedkar had said that we have framed one of the best constitution of the world. But if the people who are supposed to implement it, they don't have character, then no constitution is going to be successful. So the problem lies there. And as far as this problem of corruption is considered, I think this is the biggest problem facing the country.
Yes,
and the nexus of the politicians and bureaucrats, which is responsible for this, they are extremely powerful. It is very difficult, to bring them to the book. So I have always worked like a team. I am completely convinced that alone a civil servant can't bring about the changes. So we have to work in a team, like we have to take help of the media, we have to involve voluntary sector, there are some bona fide NGOs also, and then judiciary has also a very important role. For I will just elaborate with one example, like in Kurukshetra, it was my first posting. So there was a wildlife sanctuary, there was damages by some very influential contractors. I tried to stop that, cases were got registered by me, but immediately I was shifted out from the scenes. But since then, the media issue was very much highlighted in the media. So immediately after my removal from the scene, the issue was taken up by an NGO, that was a genuine NGO, before the Supreme Court. Supreme Court formed a centrally empowered committee. They inquired everything. They found all the charges, violations true. The state government had to concede that wrong has been committed. And a fine of 1 crore rupees was imposed, which was then again plowed back into the conservation of sanctuary for the damages that had been done. Yes, so basically it was a teamwork. Suppose I had been working alone, the moment I was removed from the scene, the things would have been covered up, things would have been totally washed out. But then there was a like a team, so media picked up issue, then voluntary sector, then there were some advocates also who did it free of cost. So basically it had to be a teamwork. Otherwise it is very difficult to succeed against this matter.
So you were highlighted after this matter of Kurukshetra and the cases you opened in when you were the deputy director of AIIMS. Sir, after that, Aam Aadmi Party wants you to be a head of ACB, Anti-Corruption Bureau. But then central government didn't approve to that. So what was the reason behind all this?
Actually, I am bound by certain conduct rules, so I can't criticize the government. But everybody knows that that proposal was sent on 16th February 2015. So now it is almost 8 months. And it was the first thing that Delhi government had did. The very first day, it was on Monday, 16th February, the chief minister, he joined his office, and this was the first thing he did. He wrote a letter for me. And even in the case of officers whose requests were sent much after that, they were promptly relieved. They are working in the government of Delhi. So all of you know, even if I don't name it, that there are certain persons, certain, you know, interests which don't want me to join at that place.
We in our country, we see that the constitution guarantees everyone equal rights, and we envisage an equal judiciary for everyone. But we see that the thing is, power is might in our country. The people who have power, they get over everything, they do anything heinous, and they just get outside it. So what is the solution to this?
See, it is going to be a very long battle. It is, you know, the situation is very grim on the ground level. Very few honest persons are left. And wherever they are left, they are fighting a very difficult, very tough battle. Nobody knows, nobody is sure about their future. Whether it be my case or there are other civil servants also, they are highlighted in the media, they are also fighting similar tough battle. So nobody knows what is in the store in the future. So it is a very, you know, very tough battle, and the only solution is that on long-term basis, everybody would have to take some responsibility. Yes, we think that we go and vote in the elections and some angel would come and he would reform from the system.
Yes,
that thinking is not going to work. So in our own capacity, whether we are working in the government service, whether we are working in the corporate sector, we would have to think about our role, what we have to contribute as a citizen. Because only informed and empowered citizenry that is going to check this type of abuses in long term.
Yes, sir.
Honorable exceptions like one officer fighting at this place, either at that place, that they are not going to make any permanent and, you know, long lasting change over a life of a large number of people. So basically it requires individual activism. Everybody have to understand their responsibility. Only then the system can be reformed.
Yes.
Sir, indeed, you are an inspirational figure for all those sincere and honest people who are working hard to remove this rampant corruption in our country. We can see Sarkari Babus having an attitude of sab chalta hai. Sir, what is your message for such fellow countrymen?
Actually, you know that one of the most important scriptures of our land is Bhagavad Gita.
Yes.
Yes,
so, you know, basically everybody would have to understand what is his dharma or duty.
Yes.
As a civil servant, our duty is to give justice to the people.
Yes.
When, as long as I am sitting on the chair, suppose I was in the chief vigilance officer of the AIIMS.
Yes.
So it was my dharma to see that no innocent person is harassed, and the persons who are corrupt, however high or mighty they are, they may be, they are punished, they are brought to the book. So basically it comes from inner conviction. It can't be imposed, it can't be taught in the classes. The moment you begin to listen the voice of your antaratma or conscience, then basically these voices become louder and louder, and that gives you a courage, that gives you a sense of purpose in the life. And before that power, all these physical powers or all those pressures, these are nothing. So basically, we would have to realize what are our duties as an officer, as a citizen, and we would have to try our best to fulfill those duties.
So in our country, the electoral system is such that it has become a monopoly of the people who are rich. Like you yourself said that you rose from a very humble background. The people, the common man, they try every day just to have the daily bread. Under such condition, like what reforms do you suggest in our electoral procedure so that a common man, just from a humble background, who really want to serve his nation, he can rose up to a level of some officer or take part in the government policy?
I think that we should not be so much pessimistic. Actually, some very positive changes have also come in past 10 or 15 years.
Yes, sir.
Like you see in corruption cases also, nowadays even chief ministers, central ministers, senior bureaucrats have been convicted, they have been sent to jail.
Yes, sir.
If you look at the 80s or 90s, earlier also there used to be corruption and politicians or chief ministers, they used to be party to it.
Yes,
but there was no conviction, there was not such a strong judiciary or media.
Yes,
so we would also have to look at the positive type of changes. Like there were earlier, there was no RTI.
Yes,
this
yes,
is
sir.
One of the way through which yes. the citizens can participate.
Yes,
and not many of the people, they know that through RTI, even you insist on inspecting the works. Not only you can seek the documents, there is provision also in the RTI Act that you can insist on inspection of the works, physical works like roads or any other civil work that has been done. You can insist to inspect those things.
Yes,
so after RTI Act has come, citizens have become more and more empowered. Then a system of PIL has developed in our country.
Yes, sir.
So you would have seen that in big corruption cases, the courts are monitoring the progress of the investigation. And some very senior ministers were also sent to the jail, like in the 2G scam or even in the coal scam. So these are the positive developments that they are taking place. And I would also like to say that in our country, the roots of democracy are very deep. And we have just to, work more and more to make it more participative. Like now people are more aware, media is also more aware. Earlier corruption cases were not reported like that. Now, once a corruption case is brought into the public domain, then media follows it. There are stories after stories and revelations. So things are changing, but they are at a slow pace. So we need to bring more and more changes at a faster pace.
So, but sometimes in many of the incidents in the past, we have seen that the report that was given by the media that was influenced by other factors. I mean, the newspaper or the channel, they only show what is in their interest. So that sends a very wrong message to the common man, because the only source of information for them is either the newspaper or the news channel. So what solution do you have for that?
Actually, in media sector also, there is, so much competition. I don't think that at any particular point of time, all the channels or all the print media would be reporting things in a wrong manner. There may be some particular channels.
Yes,
there are, they have some particular ideology.
Yes,
so they will not show anything which goes against the party of that particular ideology.
Right.
They will dilute it or they will simply block it out.
Yes,
but I don't think that at a particular point of time, all the channels or all the newspapers will paint a wrong picture. So as long as competition is there, earlier there used to be only, Doordarshan.
Yes,
so at that time it was possible, but now, there are so many channels, so many competition for that breaking news.
Yes, sir.
So I think that is the best safeguard for any such type of misleading or wrong report. But obviously, media is also a business. And for successful running any business, you need government support in one form or other.
Yes,
so I would say that our media is not also 100% clean. There are certain pulls and pressures. Sometimes news have been blocked, stories have been dumped.
Yes,
so that happens. That is a part of reality. That happens.
Anyone who wants to raise his voice against corruption and all, his voice is either daba diya jata hai sir, or either he is given threats to death or
so that he compromises.
He is suited.
That is the problem. There are many government officers were, you know, physically also eliminated. Like you would have heard the case of Satyendra Dubey,
yes,
who was engineer in the NHAI,
yes,
or Manjunath Shanmugam. So there were cases also where the officers were physically eliminated. And then apart from that physical threat, you know, always there is threat to career. Your promotion may be withheld, or your SCRs may be spoiled, or you may be placed under suspension. So those are professional hazards. Those are always there, though remedy lies in the courts. And particularly in my case, I have seen that I have always got support from the courts, in all my cases. So these are the problems. These are the risks you have to take. When you take such type of decisions, you know what are the consequences.
Yes, sir.
So basically, it is your decision, and you may perish or you may come out victorious.
Yes, sir.
So that risk is always there.
Sir, don't you think some special security must be given to those people who try to raise their voices?
In some cases, courts have given. Like that, you know, Vyapam scam.
Yes,
you would have all heard.
Yes, sir.
Those people had also met me 2 days before their entire team had come. So, to them, police security has been given. In some cases, when the courts feel so, the police security has been given. But again, as one of you had asked, that our legal system,
yes, sir,
it is not possible for everyone, particularly is an honest officer, to, you know, our legal services, our big advocates, big lawyers, they are so, you know, costly that it is not possible for everyone to approach them,
yes,
to approach the courts and to get the desired relief.
Yes, sir.
So that is a thing that on which, you know, people should work out. We also, me and some other officers are also now trying to work out something,
yes,
like a luge organization where at least we can provide legal help.
Yes, sir.
So that at least his job is secure, and
yes,
if some security is needed,
yes,
court may order and his case may be put before the court in an effective manner. So we are now working on some sort of arrangement for that.
Sir, don't you think that like this much power in the hands of netas and all must not be given? Like in your Kurukshetra case, when you were fighting against them, you were suspended. So don't you think that there should be some measure of power, like they must not be given that much power to suspend you or transfer you? Then you won't face that much difficulties and you will work properly against them.
Actually, in such cases, actually the major blame lies with our own civil services. In our constitution, there is a complete chapter on the civil services.
Yes, sir.
And they have been given, you know, one of the best protection in the entire world. It is literally impossible to throw us out of the job.
Yes, sir.
Even after so much problems with the establishment and with the most powerful persons in the establishment, my job is intact. I have been able to get all the promotions, postings, deputation. All my ACRs are outstanding.
Yes,
so there is provisions in the system. And in fact, Neta doesn't act alone. Below him, there is a complete administrative hierarchy like Chief Secretary,
yes,
Secretary,
yes,
DGP. If those people are persons of integrity, caliber, persons of character, they would not, nobody can force them to write any file noting or anything on the file,
yes,
which,
sir,
can help them out to for in any illegal action or decision.
Yes, sir.
So the problem lies there.
Okay.
Just for, you know, some petty posting, for career progression, for making illegal money, they have simply surrendered before, you know, that
okay,
corrupt politicians.
Politician.
So suppose, for example, I was placed to be under suspension.
Yes, sir.
So the chief minister can't do it. He would require a noting from an officer at the level of the commissionary. Then it would go to another senior officer, then it would go to the head of department, then it would go to the principal secretary, then to chief secretary, and then to the chief minister.
Okay.
If anybody in between writes a clear-cut noting that, no, this person was basically implementing law of the land, his actions were right,
yes,
these are the acts which he was implementing, and if we suspend him, it would be violation of the law.
Yes, sir.
No politician has guts to implement that.
Okay.
Yes,
the problem is that the moment a phone comes, all of them fall in the line. And from, you know, when I was removed from the post of CBO,
yes, sir,
there were 20 signatures within a period of 24 hours. Right from the section officer to the undersecretary to the joint secretary, additional secretary and the minister. So within 24 hours, there were 20 signatures. So it was like a command performance.
Okay.
If they had denied, if they had refused to sign the, you know, that noting,
yes, sir,
nothing would have occurred to them. Nobody could have been placed under suspension or charge sheeted, nothing.
Yes,
but just to be in the good books.
Okay.
So just to draw some, you know, undue favor in some future date.
Yes, sir.
All fell in line. So
okay,
that is the basic problem lies with our civil service.
Yes, sir.
They are very educated persons. They are very talented persons.
Yes,
their
sir
job is secure. And despite you can say as corporate sector compared to corporate sector we get a low salary, but you can lead a very well decent life. You get yes, a Bangalore staff even in the worst of the posting.
Yes, sir.
So even after that, if you are compromising like this, then the fault is with the civil services. Yes.
So if you talk about the careers, like you just said that civil services, it's a very decent job and a very honorable one. But still we see among the youth today, they prefer private jobs like IT sector and the corporate sector over the civil services or be it any other government sector job. So any message for such people?
Actually, there are two basic reasons of this trend. One, you know that exam process of civil services is very lengthy and very uncertain.
Yes, sir.
It, I don't know what is the position nowadays, but in our times, it used to take 1 or 2 years. So, just to sit idle for 1 or 2 years, it is very socially also very difficult for you.
Yes.
So that is one of the deterring factors.
Yes,
suppose if it had been like 4 or 5 months, just you would get the results.
Yes, sir.
So I think that more and more people would have been appearing.
Yes, sir. Yes.
And second, yes, of course, as a civil servant, I would not use the word problem, but it is much more challenging.
Yes, sir.
You are interacting with one of the dirtiest elements of the society.
Yes,
and you know, sometimes you may get posting in very far off places, right, from your place of residence, like in Northeast or in some other places. So these are, and then such type of stories which come in the media that he was doing his duty, he was suspended, he was killed.
Yes,
so everybody wants to lead a comfortable life.
Yes, sir.
So that I think that are the main reasons. But from my own experience, I can say that this is a very satisfying career.
Yes, sir.
And you get decent money also, you have respect in the society also, in the general people also, among the citizens also. And that thing is simply invaluable. That experience and that sense of satisfaction, that sense of purpose, you are not going to get in any service, how much highly paid it may be. You are not going to get that.
Sir, like we all know, you are a very good, very big movie buff. So, sir, in the recent past, any movie that left a deep impact on you?
Actually, movies, you know, just it is for, you know, just to unwind yourself,
yes,
basically, because all other 5 days of the week, we are in so much confrontation and all those things that, you know, that it is just a sort of thing that we want to get out of that frame of mind.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So, but in recent times, some very good movies had come. You know, in 2013, there was Prakash had made Satyagraha. Basically, it was loosely on the that Anna Hazare movement.
Yes, sir.
This year also, some very good movies had come like that, you know, from artistic point of view. Sujit Sarkar, he is always a very good director.
Yes,
his movie Madras Cafe was very good.
Yes,
Piku this year, this was also a very good movie. Then, you know, lighter side like Tanu Vets Manu, it was also a very popular movie. So, but again, it is with our college time friends, they have come to Delhi. So, we go together to watch the movies.
Sir, as we see that urbanization and industrialization is exponentially growing, but it is growing on the cost of environment. You being an IFS officer, have worked a lot for protecting and preserving the forest resources. So what message you would like to give, or what difficulties you faced that you would like to tell during that period, sir?
Actually, you know, environment is one thing that if you cause damage to it, you are not going to get it back.
Yes, sir.
Like the areas which once are turned into desert areas, or suppose that a hill which you mine it out, you know that mining is a big threat to environment nowadays, and the persons who are behind the illegal mining, there is such huge transaction of money that entire elections are run from that illegal money. You would have heard mining scandals of Jharkhand in which its chief minister was arrested, then of Bellari, then in Odisha. It is a illegal transaction of thousands of crores of rupees. So once you flatten a hillock,
yes,
you are not going to get it back, however amount of money you are going to spend it.
Yes, sir.
So I think that people would have to basically understand the value of the environment, value of our natural assets.
Yes,
even you, even if there is a, you know, pristine or virgin forest area,
yes,
you destroy it, once you divert it for some project,
yes,
you are not going to that type of forest.
Yes, sir.
Our basic principle of our environmental laws is that before initiating any development project,
yes,
basically you assess that how much this project will bring economic and social benefits,
yes, sir,
and how much it will damage the environment. This is called environment impact assessment.
Yes, sir.
So, depending on those two factors, a project is cleared.
Okay.
But of late, what has happened that the projects are being cleared in indiscriminate manner.
Yes,
it has like become a target that who is the minister who is giving the maximum number of clearances.
Okay.
So, merit is, left. and it is like a mechanical thing that you give more and more clearance because
yes,
you
yes, sir.
Get so-called GDP and economic growth.
Yes, sir.
So we would have to strike a balance in between.
Yes, sir.
So that is important thing. Again, the awareness among the people. Nowadays, media is also taking up environmental
yes,
issues in very prominent manner.
Yes,
our judiciary is also has also contributed very much. You may be aware that in every High Court and Supreme Court, there is a green bench.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Headed by the Chief Justice.
Yes, sir.
And there are fixed days of Monday and Friday on which hearings take place.
Yes, sir.
So, on this front, because of judicial interventions, we have been able to save many of our natural assets.
Yes. So, you personally being an NIT alumni, so what do you think that instead of opening new IITs or NITs, should we do some reforms in the already existing ones so as to improve the condition that is existing right now?
Yes, that is true. Because in our time when we were doing the engineering, there were just hardly, 10 or 15 engineering
yes,
colleges
sir.
In
yes,
the
sir.
Undivided UP.
Yes, sir.
And there was a quality. Then we used to have a sense of pride that we are doing BTEC
yes,
or
BE.
Nowadays, in every city, in every, lane, by lane,
yes,
there is one engineering college.
Yes, sir.
And, engineering studies is not so easy.
Yes,
you have to have some, basic level of intelligence. So, obviously, the quality of students is very poor, quality of faculty is very
yes,
poor,
sir.
There is
yes,
no
sir.
Infrastructure. So, basically, we are generating some half-baked personalities who are neither
yes,
engineers,
yes,
nor
sir.
They are humanities graduate. They are
yes,
worth nothing like.
Yes, sir.
That is, their employability is, very poor.
Yes, sir.
So, that is always there. And
yes,
we are taking bhed chal.
Yes,
that in our society, we have to make our kids engineer or doctor. So, everybody would
yes,
try.
Sir.
So, we should basically focus on the quality. And that is why that we have so much numbers, but our contribution to research and
yes,
on the global, global
yes,
level is so less.
Yes,
because we have been emphasizing on the, quantity, not quality. So, that is the right thing. If we could strengthen our existing infrastructures,
yes,
we can provide better facilities and better teaching faculties. I think
yes,
it would be better.
Yes.
Sir, where do you see your college, MNNIT, in future?
I would always like to say it be on the top. And every year I follow, in the magazines or like Individual Outlook
yes,
when there are surveys of ranking. So I always search for my college, where my college is standing. And if,
yes,
if it is, mostly I have found it in top 10 many a time.
Yes,
so I always feel very good. So I always want my college to be on the top of it.
Yes.
I was also discussing with the directors also. So basically all of us has to make efforts.
So, after Raman Magsaysay, what is the next step? I mean, what are you looking forward to?
Actually, now I would be trying to work on a more, institutional level. Like I told earlier that we would be working for creating some platform for other similar honest officers
yes,
who are fighting a lone and difficult battle to provide them legal help or other type of assistance which we can provide. And basically now I would also like try an awareness front. Like the basic purpose of coming to this
yes,
place was that if I can speak to the youth,
yes,
to the new students, and even if 1 or 2% of them can, act accordingly in the future, it would be, something very personally satisfying for
yes,
me. So nowadays I am getting so many invitations from colleges and IIT Kanpur had also invited in Delhi also colleges had invited. So nowadays I am interacting with young officers
yes,
or youth so that at least as a youth mind is very pure. You are not having that baggage of ideology and caste and all those things.
Yes, sir.
So I think at this level if something could be worked out, it would be the best thing.
Yes, sir.
So you are proud alumni of MNNIT. So, sir, don't you think more and more students like you should be nurtured here?
Actually, I was also saying in the morning also that, our representation of our college is very, is not very good in the civil services. In the engineering services, our tradition was that in engineering services in the railways, we have a fairly good representation.
Yes, sir.
But I don't know how it happened that somehow preparation for the civil services was not much in our culture. So, I think that I would be very happy if more and more persons from my college are joining in the civil services.
Yes, yes, sir.
Because that would be good for the college also, for the society also. And basically, as an engineer, I have always believed that engineers can be better administrators. Though yes, government and UPSC thinks otherwise, they always try to discourage the engineers.
Yes, sir.
But as an engineer, you know that we have always an analytical sense of mind.
Yes, sir.
We focus on efficiency. Basically, we focus on delivering the results.
Yes, sir.
So, that things are always there in, engineer, whether it be of mechanical, electrical, chemical, but
yes,
this is basic bent of mind. And this is very much necessary in the system to bring out the results.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So, I have always believed that engineers can be best administrators. And I always feel that they are the most intelligent persons also. Though my colleagues from other backgrounds in our services, they never agreed with us. Knowledge of humanities is necessary just to know how the society has evolved or what, like sociology or history.
Yes, sir.
But you know, if you have to deliver, then you need a engineering bent of mind.
Yes,
you have to analyze the problems.
Yes,
you have to work out the solutions, and then in an efficient manner, you have to bring the results.
Yes, sir.
And that is basically, that is what an engineering education makes in 4 years.
So, finally, sir, taking not much of your time, sir, concluding this.
No, you are free. Yes.
So, what is the message to all the MNNITians?
Actually, I would just like to say that every one of us should, understand our duties for our country, for our nation. Ours is a country which has been endowed so much with the nature. We have one of the best soil class in the world. We have so many rivers, so many water resources, a very good amount of rainfall. We have so many mineral resources. Our forest areas are one of the richest in the world. We are hub to so much biodiversity.
Yes, sir.
We are home to the largest number of the youngest persons in the world.
Yes, sir.
So in spite of all those human and natural resources, this is the one problem of lack of ethics or bad governance or corruption,
yes,
whatever you may say, that has not allowed us to realize our true potential.
Yes, sir.
You can see the countries like Japan or Israel.
Yes, sir.
2/3 of Japan is covered by the hills.
Yes, sir.
But you can see what they have achieved.
Yes, sir.
Similar is the case of the Israel. What they have achieved in the defense electronics or in the agriculture. Israel is a desert. It is a very small country. And we have not been able to, develop any core area, even in engineering or in research. So, all these things, lack of ethics and our, ethnic divisions.
Yes, sir.
So, these things are holding us back. So, my simple message is that we should understand our responsibility, our duty for the society. And we should not look that other peoples are not doing their duty or they have indulged in wrong things.
Yes, sir.
They are materially very prospering. We should see what are our duties and in our best possible ways, in whichever sector we should try to contribute for the welfare of the nation.
Sir, thank you for your wonderful time.
It was a pleasure.
It was a very nice opportunity.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot.